The latest in tech and accessibility. This is Access Tech Live with Stephen Scott and Marc Aflalo.
So joining us now on the show is a familiar voice and face to AMI TV audiences. He is a regular on the series Kelly and Ramya, and he's worked on several stories for Double Tap TV in the past. Grant Hardy, welcome here to Access Tech Live.
Fantastic to be here, and I can't wait to talk some tech with you.
Oh, okay. That's going to be great, right? So roll up your sleeves. Let's dive in. But before we delve into the week's news headlines, I want to mention quickly, because last week we talked about TransLink, which is Vancouver's transit authority, officially announcing the Braille integration across all of their stops. Now, living in Vancouver yourself, we've got to ask you this. Have you had a chance to check this out?
Yeah, I mean, I do take transit quite frequently. And at the end of the day, there's only so close that you can get to a bus stop with your phone, right? You can maybe get a few meters away. Plus, of course, it's important to remember some people don't have access to that GPS technology. And just standing at a pole and listening to the bus going past you and thinking, oh, crap, I'm at the wrong spot again, can be really infuriating. And now having this option to know exactly when you're standing at a bus stop by looking at the Braille, just like a sighted person would look at the sign and see, you know, what buses are coming to this stop, it's really fantastic. So hats off to them for making this really just standard across the board.
Yeah, I hope we get other companies in other provinces and cities to learn a lesson from this, because this is something that should be natural across the board, especially with adding like light rail systems and stuff like that. Grant, when we were kind of preparing for the show, we were talking about some of the things that we're interested for you to talk about specifically this week. One of which was, you know, the meta story about encrypting all the private messages across, obviously, Facebook Messenger and WhatsApp. Can you break that down a little bit for people who don't really understand what that means at the end of the day for them?
Yeah, I mean, essentially, end-to-end encryption means that your data can only be accessed between you and your recipient in the case of a message. But if there's some sort of a data breach in the cloud, or someone tried to, you know, social engineer Meta or Apple or whoever it is to get access to your account, or even, yes, in the case of law enforcement trying to get access to that data, they will not physically not be able to do so without knowing your passcode, your password, all your security information needed to log into the account, because it's not a question of just securing your account, but your data is actually encrypted based upon your login info. So it's physically impossible for someone to access it.
That's a fair description. I think it narrows it down for people who don't really understand what that means. I'm curious, you know, your thoughts on the importance of this, because there's a careful balance here that we need to have between obviously protecting our personal information and what we think is private. You know, sometimes, you know, who cares about a chat between myself and my son? But you also have to balance it with the law enforcement side of things, because by doing this, yes, we're, you know, Meta's doing a great service to their customer base and we feel a little bit more protected, but do we really feel that safe if for some reason someone needs to get access to that and they can't?
So I think it's really important to acknowledge the fact that we live in a very vulnerable world where people, including law enforcement, don't always behave properly. I mean, we're in a world where, you know, women are concerned about just some random private citizen or the government suing them or arresting them for maybe traveling out of state to have an abortion. You know, there are lots of other issues like that where the laws that we have and the governments that are in power don't necessarily always act in a way that we would consider socially just or appropriate. And there are a lot of these examples where I kind of talk to people and they're like, you know, if I have nothing to hide, you know, why would I have to worry? But something like this, you know, people kind of go like, okay, I get it. Like, I kind of get why non-criminals, the good guys, quote unquote, would want that end-to-end encryption. I also think that it's incredibly clear that we cannot secure our accounts without it. Like, it's just impossible. There's so many data breaches. We just had a big data breach with the DNA matching website. Many, you know, Apple accounts and other accounts have been stolen through just basic social engineering, convincing a human who wants to be helpful to help you get into an account that's not yours. So I think that if we don't want privacy to be an antiquated concept, we really do need this end-to-end encryption. Also, just wanted to mention the fact that law enforcement, like, they do have a lot of might on their side. Like, you might not be handing them your data on a silver platter, but they're pretty powerful. If they wanted to install something to spy on your router at home, you know, maybe a camera to, you know, capture your passcode, whatever they want to do, you may not be handing them your data on a silver platter, but I just don't agree with the concept of, like, they're going to go black. Like, I feel that they're going to figure out a way to get the data that they need to get. Curious what you guys think. So basically, well, I'm a very pro-privacy, pro-encryption person.
Yeah, I'm with you on this, Grant, but I think most people aren't. And, you know, and I hear, you know, young people these days, I even hear people my own age who post pictures of their kids regularly on Facebook, and they don't think about, for example, geo-locking or geolocating those photographs. So, for example, you know, the information that's actually in the image itself that gives away the location it was taken. You know, people don't realize that. How many friends do you know go off on holiday and take snaps while they're on holiday, basically telling everybody on Facebook or on Instagram or whatever else, we're not here, our house is sitting empty, and you can, you know, feel free to burgle if you want. You know, that's the problem with all of this, right? I don't know, you know, I get what you're saying, but I think, does that really translate to the average person? Do they know about all the settings that need to be fixed and adjusted to make sure that their data is safe?
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, and I think that's a good example of what I mean, is that the world is just kind of a privacy nightmare at the moment. And I think that some younger people either don't care or, like, literally think that privacy is just an antiquated concept, especially because of all the data breaches that are happening. But I don't agree. Like, I think things should be built in a way where you don't even have to worry about the settings. You know, it's just like the data security on your phone. It just sort of works. You don't even have to know how it's secured. But, you know, behind the scenes, there's some very powerful forces at play. But I agree in the sense that I honestly feel like we might lose this fight, because none of people really care or understand the consequences of winning or losing this fight. I don't know.
Yeah, I think there's a whole show and a whole, you know, conversation to be had about just the basic things you can do to secure devices, not only for yourself, but for family members around there. I want to touch briefly on the iOS 17.2 update, because a lot of people ask me, oh, should I do this? Is it important? And when they come to me, I always say, listen, this is not going to mess up software. This is one of these things that really is there to, yeah, bring new features to the table, but also secure your device and secure vulnerabilities. Do you jump on updates when they first come out?
Absolutely. If I haven't installed them in advance during the beta cycle, or at least the release candidate, I absolutely jump on it right away. I am someone who, whenever I look back on the journals that I've made throughout the years, it's just such a wonderful way to reflect on my life. So I've immediately started using the journal app. I'm kind of someone who tends to jump on all of the features. And as you said, there's some really great features, especially now some better protections for knowing if your iMessages are intercepted, and a lot of other security things like that. So yes, absolutely, I jump on updates pretty much immediately if there are no show-stopping bugs that I've heard about.
Okay, Grant, stick around. We're going to take a quick break and come back with Matthew Schifrin, and then bring you back and talk a little bit about Braille. Obviously, the conversation about Braille starts with, of course, this gentleman who's going to be joining us after the quick break. He found a way to make Lego accessible for himself and for others. And then guess what? Lego actually took notice and took it to a whole new level. So let's take a quick break and come back with Matthew Schifrin. And of course, Grant, stick around. We're going to come back to you a bit later.
We want to hear from you. Follow us on social media and get involved at Access Tech Live. We'll be right back.